of Marianne Buddy, the Bishop of the Diocese of Washington, and all of us who serve this cathedral, welcome. We're so glad that you've decided to join us for this important conversation this evening. Convening conversations, bringing people together to discuss some of the most important issues of the day, is one of the cathedral's core priorities. Since 2008, the Nancy and Paul Ignatius program has given this cathedral a wonderful opportunity to focus on many important issues, issues that sit at the intersection of faith and public life. The Nancy and Paul Ignatius Program Fund was established by Nan and Paul's children, David, Sarah, Amy, and Adi Ignatius, their friends and other relatives, as a recognition of Nan and Paul's service and commitment to Washington National Cathedral. While we said goodbye to Nan last year, her legacy lives on here at the cathedral, and we are so pleased to have Paul as the mainstay of our cathedral community. Not to mention that this year's Ignatius program is especially important because yesterday, Paul Ignatius celebrated his 100th birthday. Happy birthday, Paul, and God bless and keep you. Thank you for all that you have done for so many. Our topic for tonight could not be more relevant or timely. The impact of this pandemic on our nation has been immense. Every week, this cathedral holds a service specifically to pray for those by name, for many of those who have lost their lives to COVID-19. And who among us this time last year could have imagined that we would see 230,000 Americans who have lost their lives, and the number only growing. Over the past 10 months, we have experienced a lot of loss and heartbreak, yet at the same time, we have witnessed the self-sacrifice and heroic efforts of first responders and medical personnel and frontline workers. Moreover, we're beginning to see the fruits of the incredible efforts made by scientists around the world to find a vaccine for this virus, and to do so at a pace never seen before. The truth is, there has been much suffering and loss, but there is also much to be thankful for. So, where do we go from here? My thanks to Dr. Luciana Borio and Dr. Francis Collins and Dr. Anthony Fauci for being our guests tonight to tackle that question and so many others. So if you will permit me, I'd like to begin this evening with a prayer. If prayer is something meaningful in your life, I hope you'll join us. Join me. Let us pray. O God, our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble, we pray for all those affected by COVID-19 around the world. Remove the presence of fear and anxiety from our hearts and heal all those who are sick with the virus. Give skill and sympathy and resilience to all those who are caring for the sick and your wisdom to those searching for a cure. Strengthen them all with your spirit that through their work many will be restored to health. All these things we pray in your holy name. Amen. And now it's my pleasure to turn this over to the oldest of the Ignatius children, David Ignatius.
I'm David Ignatius, a columnist for the Washington Post. On behalf of all of the Ignatius family, and with thanks to this wonderful cathedral, I would like to welcome you to a special discussion of the topic that our nation and the world are thinking about more than any other, COVID-19. Where do we go from here? We've had some hopeful news in the past week with the announcement of a vaccine whose phase 3 test results our keynote speaker, not a man given to hyperbole, described as really quite good. I mean extraordinary. And we've had the chilling news of what appears to be a winter surge of the virus, with infection totals rising every day and hospitals around the country straining to treat patients. We're blessed tonight to have three of the wisest doctors in America and indeed in the world help us think about where we're going and how to protect our families, our country, and the world from this scourge of the pandemic. A word about our format tonight. We'll open with a conversation between my brother, Adi Ignatius, editor-in-chief of the Harvard Business Review, and Dr. Anthony Fauci. Now, many of you may not have heard of Dr. Fauci, so I will explain that he's director of the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Disease, that for decades he's been our nation's leading expert on infectious disease, and a person who gives us faith that science and reason will prevail in the end. Following their discussion, my sister Amy Ignatius, a Superior Court judge in New Hampshire, will moderate a response to Dr. Fauci from Dr. Francis Collins, director of the National Institutes of Health, and Dr. Luciana Borio, who served in the Obama administration as acting chief scientist at the FDA, then directed medical and biodefense preparedness for the Trump administration from 2017 to 2019, and is now a member of President-elect Joe Biden's coronavirus task force. Finally, a word about the Ignatius program. As Dean Hollerith said, my siblings and I helped establish this event 12 years ago to honor our parents, Paul and Nancy Ignatius, who have cherished their relationship with this cathedral. Over these dozen years, we've had many important speakers, including Zbigniew Brzezinski, Brent Scowcroft, Bill Perry, John Kerry, Susan Rice, and many others. But we've never had a more important topic or more compelling panelists than tonight. As you know from Dean Hollerith, Paul Ignatius, our father, celebrated his 100th birthday last night. If you want to think about how to stay healthy in these COVID times, he's your man. It's fitting that his birthday is Veterans Day because he spent a lifetime serving his country as a combat veteran in World War II, later as Secretary of the Navy, and truly in everything he does. My brother Adi, my sister Amy, and my sister Sarah, who runs the National Association of Armenian Studies and Research and is the only Ignatius you won't see on stage tonight, we would like to dedicate this program to our father and to the memory of his wife of 71 years, our late mother, Nancy Ignatius. So now to Dr. Fauci and my brother Adi.
All right, thank you very much, David, and Dean Holler for getting us started. So David has introduced Dr. Fauci. I won't add to that except to say he left out two key things. He has his own Topps baseball card and a bobblehead doll that somehow in this weird year that is 2020, America's leading rock star is an epidemiologist. So here's my first question. President Trump has suggested he might fire you. President-elect Biden has said he might promote you. You're a 79-year-old man, which sounds like a better deal.
Well, I think the important response to that, which I get asked often, is that my job as a director of an NIH institute and as a public health official is to focus entirely on what my mission and our goal is, which is to use science and health to preserve the health, the safety, and the welfare of the American people, regardless of what the administration is. As you know, and many people know, that I have had the privilege of serving six presidents since I became director of the NIAID in 1984. And that's what we focus on as scientists. I know we're living in a charged political environment, but that's something that is not primary for us. We just continue to do our job to foster public health, but also to do the science that leads to the things like the vaccine that you mentioned in the introduction, that was just mentioned by the dean in the introduction. So that's what I focus on. So when you hear those things in the newspapers, many people think I get shook back and forth by that. To be honest with you, I don't.
Well, let me follow up a little bit on that. So I think if people saw that the program that you were going to be featured, they probably thought, that's great, this is my guy Fauci. Those people are probably Democrats. that you have this very high approval rating among half the country, among Democrats, not so high among Republicans, although the independent did a survey and said you're the only person serving under President Trump whose approval ratings have gone up instead of gone down. But, you know, on a serious note, you know, you and your family have had threats against your life because you've defended science instead of defending the White House. So how did science become so politicized?
Well, that's an important question, but also a sad that you have to ask that question, because that is what we have seen a lot in the United States, but not just restricted to the United States, because we're also seeing it with my colleagues in the UK and in Europe and in other regions of the world. I don't think there's a simple explanation for it, but I think there has been an anti-authority component to this. You know, we had anti-vax. People don't like to be told to be vaccinated. Scientists are often perceived as authoritarian, and sometimes, in fact, they've made that perception themselves by the way they act. I think we can improve on that. But right now, it has been just lumped into the politics of what's going on. We live in a divisive society, and even if we didn't have a pandemic, it would be a divisive society. And the fact that we do have a pandemic, and a pandemic is a public health issue, and public health is intimately related to science, that all of a sudden, science gets caught in a lot of this divisiveness. And that's unfortunate. And what we as scientists hope, I know that my colleague Francis Collins feels the same way, that when we get past this, science will resume its really rightful place in being something that's for everyone without divisions.
Will we get past this, meaning COVID-19, or
yes,
will we get past this?
COVID-19. I think when we get out of the charged nature of the stress and the strain that's put upon us by an outbreak, people will realize the importance of science.
So let's talk about where we are now. I mean, there has been really a terrifying spike in new cases, hospitalizations, deaths. Where, you know, as you look at this and the spread of this thing, where are we in the cycle?
Well, data speaks for itself. We are in a very, very difficult situation. It's quite problematic. I have said that publicly many times, not to scare people, but to bring a reality check to where we are. If you look at it, we have 10 million infections in the United States, almost 250,000 deaths. We've had 60,000 hospitalizations. And now, last count, we had 143,000 infections in a single day. When I testified before the Congress 4 months ago, I said if we did not get control of this, that we could reach 100,000 infections a day. And people thought I was being hyperbolic. And now look what's happening. That's the bad news. I think the encouraging news that people need to understand, that public health measures, not lockdown of the country, but public health measures that are rather simple and easy to understand, the universal wearing of masks, the physical distancing, the avoiding congregate in crowded places, outdoors better than indoors, washing hands. It sounds simple in the context of this ominous outbreak, but in fact, it can turn it around, and that's what we really need to do.
So to be at this level now of this new spike, is that just a lethal pandemic kind of working its way through the country, through the world, or are we doing something just horribly wrong to be at that place again?
Well, I wouldn't say it's horribly wrong. I think what we have not done, and it isn't just the United States. I think if you look at what's going on in Europe and the UK now, they are in many respects in the same boat as we are with major surges. But would you look at what happened in our own country, that we did not act in a unified way. I always say one of the wonderful things about our country that I love so much is that we're the United States of America. And we're a federalist country, and we have states' independence, and they have, in some respects, important that they are that way. However, when you're dealing with an infectious disease, the infectious disease doesn't know the difference of the border between Mississippi and Louisiana, or between Florida and Georgia and South Carolina. And an infectious disease means the entire country. We did not approach it that way. We had too much individual approaches towards how we were going to handle the outbreak. So our baseline never came down to the low level that we wanted it to be. So when community spread came in as we try to open the country, it just soared right up. And it's a self-propagating issue. because the more community spread you get, the more difficult it is to contain it by identification, isolation, and contact tracing. Because there's so much of it going on, it becomes very difficult. That's the problem we're in right now. We have an enormous amount of community spread.
So if your model was telling you a while back that, you know, we could have 100,000 cases a day, what is it telling you now as you look forward to the winter, cold weather? What are we facing?
Well, you know, models are as good as the assumption you put into the model. I have been one to challenge models, not challenge the validity of the modeling process, but to challenge the assumptions that are put into it. If we all literally pushed together as a group and did it in a uniform way, we do not necessarily need to see the 1,000 to 1,300 deaths per day. We don't need to see the 140,000 infections per day. We can turn it around. So if we stay the way we are, you do the simple math. 1,000 deaths a day, 140,000 cases a day, you multiply it by 31 days in December, you know, 2 weeks more left in November. By the time you get to January 1st, we have a really, really bad situation. So what I'm saying as a public health official, and as my colleagues say, we don't need to accept that. And I want to make one point, if I may, that's important. I know you're going to get to it in the questions. But one of the things about a vaccine, which is really important, not only in and of itself as being a tool that's essential to end this outbreak, when people know that help is on the way, and what I mean by help is on the way is that we will start giving vaccines in December. And then as we get into January, February, March, we'll get the prioritization of the people who need it the most. If we can focus that that is there, there's light at the end of the tunnel, I hope we can get over what we call COVID fatigue, where people are so exhausted with the public health measures that they really feel like they almost want to either give up and say, let's do what you want to do, which is not the time to do that now. Now we need to double down on the public health measures as we're waiting for the vaccine to come and help us out.
So there's COVID fatigue and there's COVID resistance, or resistance to taking the measures you're talking about. Is there, in your mind, is there hard data, hard evidence that these behaviors that you would call reckless, you know, big political rallies where people aren't wearing masks, motorcycle rallies, whatever, is there clear data that those have led to outbreaks?
Yeah, I think it's pretty clear when you've seen congregate settings where people gathered indoors without a mask. There's no doubt that you see. We've seen that with the Sturgis rally. We've seen that with a number of other situations. We have seen it in clear-cut examples of people getting together in a congregate way, particularly indoor, where you trace after that, there's clear outbreaks. Mm-hmm.
All right, so you talked about vaccines, so let's talk about vaccines.
Let's talk about vaccines.
You know, Pfizer got our attention with its announcement recently about 90% efficacy for its trial. Tell me what you know, there are a lot of tests. What are you seeing? You said you thought there'd be vaccines being rolled out in December. Talk a little bit about what you're excited about and maybe specifically what you're seeing.
Well, I mean, if you look at infectious diseases in general, what you need to get society protected, you need a certain number of the people who are protected because they're immune to the virus. There are a couple of ways to do that. One way is very painful, is that everybody gets infected. That leads to a lot of deaths. That is unacceptable way to get this virus under control. The other way is to have a highly effective vaccine that the vast majority of the population takes. So in other words, if you have a 50%, 60% effective vaccine, that even if the majority take it, there's still a large segment of the population that is not immune. But we are fortunate because the first one out of the gate is more than 90%, probably close to 95% effective. So what we're hoping is that those who have vaccine hesitancy, who are skeptical about a vaccine, will see that the efficacy of this is so high that they may change their mind about wanting to get vaccinated. The other part of the good news is that there are other vaccines, some that are almost identical, such as the Moderna product, which will be evaluated in the next week to a few days, that we anticipate, though you never want to get ahead of yourself, that it will be as good or close to that. If that's the case, then you have two of them. So we have the capability, what science has done in an unprecedented way. If this were 15, 20 years ago, it would have taken a few years to get to where we are now. The idea that you went from a recognition of the virus on July 9th with the sequence to a phase one trial, literally 60 some odd days later, to a phase three trial a few months later, to a vaccine that we're going to be giving to people next month is extraordinary. And that's what I said when I said how I described it. I mean, I've been doing this for 40 years, and this is really extraordinary. But as extraordinary as it is, what we don't want people to do is to say, oh, we have a vaccine now, so we're done. We're not done. We still need to implement public health measures in a very intense way.
But when you say the vaccine will be rolled out in December, that means for frontline workers, people at risk? I mean, what's
your timetable? The way that this happens when you have a vaccine that isn't readily available to everybody all at once is you do prioritization. That's the responsibility of the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, the CDC. They rely heavily on an advisory committee called the Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices, ACIP. They help them make the prioritization. They're only advisory. The CDC makes the ultimate. This year, we complemented that by asking the National Academy of Medicine to also weigh in. Now, I'm not going to get ahead of them in their decision, but likely it will be frontline workers like healthcare workers who are taking care of individuals, people who have underlying conditions that make them susceptible to a severe outcome were they to get infected, people in nursing homes, for example, people with underlying conditions, then children in school, adults, teachers in school, fundamental people who are responsible for making society run in an orderly way. That's the kind of prioritization you get. We hope by the time we get into the second quarter of 2021, we will have enough vaccine that we will have progressively vaccinated people so that when we get April, May, June, we'll be able to get people in the general population starting to get vaccinated.
So a guy like me who's not in a particular high-risk level, middle of the year, you think?
Yeah, I would think probably by anywhere between the end of the first quarter and the end of the second quarter.
Yeah. So then we have the problem of the people who say they will not or probably will not take the vaccine, and that number has actually increased rather than decreased in the past 6 months or so. I think for the people who are resistant because they didn't trust what anybody was saying, you talked about that showing an early efficacy of these trials. But the people who just think, no, I don't want to take a vaccine, I don't want anybody to tell me to take a vaccine, how do we move the needle on that?
Well, you've got to continually try and outreach them and do what we call community engagement. I mean, there are going to be a core of people who will not take a vaccine no matter what you do. I don't think you should give up on them, but I don't think you should necessarily expect. But there's a larger group of people who just probably have misinformation and don't understand the process. And what we've been trying to do, myself, Dr. Collins, and others, we've been trying to explain clearly what the process is of making a decision that a vaccine is safe and effective. It's an orderly process. It's done by independent groups that have no allegiance to an administration or to a company or to anyone. They make that decision. They look at the data and determine, is it safe and effective? Then there are layers of advisory committees. There's the career scientist at the FDA that I trust. There's the scientists like myself and Dr. Collins who will be looking at the data. So it's going to be a very transparent process. I don't think people who are anti-vax fully appreciate how transparent that process is. They may think there's something that's being hidden, people are trying to put something over on them. We need to reach out to them and make them realize that that's not the case. And it's to their benefit and the benefit of society to get vaccinated.
So if 50% of the population, or some, maybe not that many, but a large chunk of people do not take the vaccination, what does that mean? How does that play out? What does that mean for me if I take, what does the world look like?
I think that would be quite problematic. and it would not be good for the country in general, because if you really want to essentially crush, as that word they use, an outbreak, to get the level of transmission so low that it is no longer a public health problem. If you have 50% of the people don't get vaccinated, there's a lot of infection that's going to be going around the community. If you get a 90-95% effective vaccine and 80% of the population get vaccinated, you have an umbrella of protection already that the virus has no place to go. It would be looking for vulnerable people and not finding it. That's when it goes way down, and then it's no longer a threat. Now, if 50% of the people don't want to get vaccinated, it's going to take quite a while to get to that point.
So COVID-19 seems to be mutating in, you know, concerning ways. Is there anything, you know, that we do not know yet about COVID-19, that, you know, a mystery that continues to surprise you, or that we need to unlock?
Yeah, let me count the ways. It is a lot of that we don't know, and I think we have to be humble that we have learned an extraordinary amount over the last 10 months, but there's a lot that we do not know. And that's the reason why the studies, the cohorts, the research that we're going to be doing is going to go on for quite a while, even after we have the outbreak under control.
Yeah. So we actually solicited questions from viewers, and a lot of them were about, I've had COVID. Am I safe, both for myself and in terms of infecting anybody else? I have the antibodies. Am I safe? What do we think about those questions now?
Well, at this point in time, we do not know the durability of protection. We know that if you get infected and recover, it is very likely for a finite period of time that you are protected. It's almost certain that that's the case. We've already seen specific instances of reinfection, people who were infected, recovered, and got infected with another SARS-CoV-2. We don't know how extensive that's going to be. So even though antibodies are present in a lot of the people who recover, we don't know what level is related to protection. We don't know how long that lasts. Now, we don't want to scare people to think, oh, my God, I've got infected, and now I'm going to get infected again. Unlikely, but what we have a lot to learn is what the durability of protection is. The one thing I can say as an infectious disease person is that it is very unlikely it's going to be like measles. If you and I got infected by measles as a child, I'm sure you did also. And the fact is you're protected essentially for life. It likely is not of that magnitude because of what we know about the common cold coronaviruses that keep reinfecting people. We feel it's likely measured in several months to a year or more, but it doesn't look like it's going to be 20, 30 years, which means that people need to get vaccinated even if they've been infected before, which we think is going to happen. And it is conceivable, though not absolute, that you may need to boost people every once in a while after the vaccine, which is fine.
Yep. So more generally, are we, and by that I mean the planet, more susceptible now somehow to global pandemic? I mean, this seems like a once-in-a-lifetime occurrence, but is it? Should we be braced for more?
No. They will continue. As we've said, pandemic outbreaks over history have occurred before even recorded history, before understanding where the pathogen is. They've occurred in our own lifetime. I mean, within the memory of some people, 1918 was a disaster for the world with the flu pandemic. We have seen outbreaks, some of which have been trivial, some of which had had major impact. Right now, this is the most serious outbreak that we've had in this planet in 102 years. Will it happen again? Yes. Will it happen 10, 15, 20 years from now? We don't know. The thing about outbreaks are they are unpredictable. So as scientists, what we say, you likely cannot prevent the emergence of a new microbe. What you can prevent is that emergence from becoming a catastrophic pandemic. And that's what we mean by pandemic preparedness, to prevent the inevitable emergence of microbes. As long as we have an interface with the animal world, you know, the One Health, that 75% of all the new pathogens that have emerged have jumped from an animal species to a human. They were zoonotic and they jumped to human. So that's going to continue to happen. The question and the challenge for us is to be prepared enough so that it doesn't become a catastrophic outbreak.
So we didn't do very well this time.
No, we didn't.
So how do we more specifically, how do we avoid or mitigate, you know, the next one?
Well, there are a number of things we can do. First of all, we've got to think globally. Pandemics are global. So we have to pull together globally. There's a thing called the Global Health Security Network or agenda that was established several years ago. We need to strengthen that. We need to strengthen our international collaborations. We need to have people speaking to each other in surveillance. It's got to be open and transparent. When you do that, you can detect it early and respond early. Scientific approaches, technologies, are going to allow us to do what we did with this outbreak, rapidly make a vaccine. We can do even better than that, but you can't do science alone. It's got to be public health and classic science.
So are there countries that there are countries that seem to be doing well that then weren't doing so. Are there countries now that hold up as models for, you know, pretty good response to this?
You know, the answer is yes, but right now it seems that every country is suffering.
Yeah.
We are often compared with countries that are not comparable to us. We are not a little island of 5 million people that we can shut off. We're not a country that would accept if a ruler tells us, you must do this. I was talking with our UK colleagues just today who were saying the UK is very similar to where we are now in outbreak because each of our countries have that independent spirit of we don't want to be told what to do. Well, I understand that, but now is the time to do what you're told. And I think it really is something that we should be doing right now.
So, all right, so what you're talking about is walking the fine line between, you know, lockdown at one extreme and open activity on the other extreme. You, as a, you know, professional medical person, probably err on the side of caution and health.
Right.
But, you know, if you were president-elect, you know, how would you balance those two priorities?
You know, I believe you have to be sensitive to the stress and the strain of lockdowns, the economic and psychological consequences. I do not believe at this point that we do need to lock down. We have to leave that on the table. We're not going to just push it off the table. I don't think we need to do it because my experience is that when you as a group, as a nation, implement the public health measures that I mentioned to you, we can turn this around without locking the country down.
So you've answered the question I'm about to ask a million times, but it's probably useful for people who are tuning in to hear. There are those who think a herd immunity strategy is a good strategy.
Right.
Comment.
No, it is not. I mean, it just is not. I mean, I don't want to disrespect any of those who feel that way. That's their opinion, but it's just not the case. Because if you look now, 25%, we'll say, of the people in this country that got hit badly in New York are immune. 10% of the country as a whole, the CDC did a very good study and said about 10% of the people in the country, quote, have gotten infected or therefore protected. We have 245 to 250,000 deaths and 10 million infections. You're not going to get to herd immunity until you get somewhere up to 70 or so percent. Now, if you want to go from 10 to 70, multiply that by 7 and look at the number of people who will have to have died to get to natural herd immunity. It's not feasible, and it's not acceptable.
I've read a lot about sort of people who feel that they're suffering kind of long-term effects, survivors of COVID-19 who are having secondary long-term effects, fogginess, other things. What's the medical, you know, view on that?
Well, it's a real phenomenon.
Yeah.
We are right now, literally as we speak, in fact, this afternoon, I think it was about 3:30, Francis, we had a phone call about the approach that we're going to be taking from a scientific to try and investigate that. It's a phenomenon where people clear the virus, but for variable periods of time. And we don't know what the percentage, whether it's 20, 25, 30% of people have the persistence of symptoms that are bothersome to their function. Fatigue, shortness of breath, muscle aches, dysautonomia, inability to control temperatures, what they call brain fog, which means a real difficulty in concentrating or focusing. It sometimes can be incapacitating to people. We need to figure out what that is and what we can do about it. So we're doing a very big look at what we can do, and it likely will be some very large studies.
Yeah. So another study that seemed hopeful was this one, the nasal spray that seemed to block infections. I think it was tested on ferrets that parallel us somehow.
Right.
Is that something that you are taking seriously? Does that seem
promising? Of course. I mean, whenever you have a study that looks favorable in an animal, you are almost obliged in many respects to go ahead and carefully do a phase one study in a human, then a phase two, and then a full efficacy study. So we're going to be studying that, but I think we need to warn people that often we find that things look really promising in an animal, but it doesn't hold out in a human.
Yeah. So, again, the questions that we received from viewers before we started this, so many of them were very personal. You know, everyone's experience with either with COVID or with fear of contracting, it's very personal. People have, you know, moving and personal stories. But I know you've talked about this a lot, but I think people would love to know, what do they do at Thanksgiving? You know, this you've talked about what you will do and won't do, but, you know, any general but still relevant advice you can give?
Yeah, I think every family unit needs to do a risk assessment and a risk-benefit ratio. If you have people in your family who are elderly or who have underlying conditions that make them susceptible to severe outcome, you've got to make a decision. Do you want people to travel, to spend time in a crowded airport, to get on a plane and maybe not have time for quarantining after they get here, or not have the ability or understanding how they can get a test quickly enough? You may want to make a decision that you're just going to forestall it. Now, whenever I say that, I'm the Grinch that stole Thanksgiving. I'm not saying that. I'm saying everyone needs to seriously think about the risk benefit. And you might say, I had a wonderful I had a wonderful Thanksgiving last year. I'm looking forward to a wonderful Thanksgiving next year. But maybe right now's not the time to have 25 people in a house when you take your mask off as you're eating. Mm-hmm.
So we have time just maybe for a couple more questions. But, you know, you mentioned that this is the most serious pandemic we faced in over 100 years. And, you know, I think we go back to 1918. You know, looking back at that, and I'm sure you've looked a lot at that, is there something to learn from that, how it plays out, and whether we go the path A or path B, and there's a good path and a bad path? I mean, learning from 1918, what do we need to do?
Yeah, what we need to do right now is that we know from historical little anecdotes that actually became studies, that when people took seriously the kind of things that I'm talking about, wearing a mask, physical separation, they did much better in cities that did that than in those that just said, the heck with it, we're going to do whatever we want to do.
Yeah.
So history is kind of repeating itself 102 years later.
Yeah. So last question, you started to talk about this at the beginning, but you know, you've worked for many, many presidents, you've worked for many, many years. What keeps you in this game? I mean, it's not like you just get adulation, you also get a lot of grief. Again, you have bodyguards. I mean, what keeps you going?
Each of us choose the path we want to take in our lives. I've chosen public service in the context of medicine and science. And there's nothing more exciting to me than that, or more challenging. So it totally energizes me. So when people talk about my age and how long I've been doing it, you know, it almost seems like I've only been doing it for a short time. I have a long way to go.
All right. Well, I want to thank you very much for your work and for being here tonight.
Thank you.
Fascinating.
Thank you for having me.
Good evening. I'm Amy Ignatius, and happy to be able to continue the conversation with two extremely knowledgeable people. These are long days for you, and we appreciate so much your willingness to keep on working a few extra hours and share with us and continue the conversation that Adi and Dr. Fauci began. I also want to say, thinking about somebody who's dear to all of us who's recently left, our treasured Justice Ginsburg once said, "I'm a very strong believer in listening and learning from others." And the Ignatius program was created for that very purpose, to listen and to learn. And so it is a great pleasure to be able to work with the two of you to continue that conversation. You have such expertise, each of you, in such difficult times. So let's get right to it. There's so much to talk about. We could spend all night, and I won't make you do that. Don't worry. President-elect Biden has just created a new task force, and he has named you, Dr. Borio, to be on that task force. I don't know if you're allowed to say much about what your mission is going to be, what your particular role will be, and whether it has started its work or not, but what can you tell us about the task force?
Sure. You know, the president-elect made very clear that he wants to be ready on the first day to begin to establish programs to counter this horrific pandemic, that he's going to work very closely with state and local officials, with the American public, to turn around the explosive numbers we're seeing, because we need to be able to, you know, reopen schools and businesses in a safe and sustainable way. We do want to go back to our way of life. And that's the work ahead. So the task force has met and is going to meet regularly to advise the president-elect, the vice president-elect, and the transition teams that are working really hard to get the administration ready to govern in January.
And Dr. Collins, you, as head of all of the institutes of health, are you able to coordinate your efforts with the task force? How does that work for you in the next couple of months?
Well, I think the good news is that the coordination, the ability to work together on this public health crisis has been truly amazing. When you look at the scientific effort, and as the director of NIH, I have a lot of opportunities to try to steer people in coordinated functions, and it has been phenomenal to see the way in which people have decided to drop everything and work together. Back in March, we had a few initial discussions, and in just 2 weeks put together the largest public-private partnership on an infectious disease that's ever been assembled, something called ACTIV, which stands for Accelerating COVID-19 Therapeutic Interventions and Vaccines. And this is about half industry people and about half NIH and academics. It's FDA, it's CDC, it's the Veterans Administration, it's the Department of Defense. It's being managed by the Foundation for NIH with extremely high levels of skill. And that has done something in just a few months that I didn't think was possible. We've had partnerships like this before. Usually they take about 2 years and at least 39 lawyers to sign off on everything. And this just got done. And people actually were willing to drop everything, put the rest of whatever they were doing aside, work 24/7, design master protocols that we could test therapeutic agents, prioritize the therapeutic agents to pick the ones that are most likely to have some promise, figure out how to do these clinical trials like overnight with the networks that were out there that had never really been organized in this way. All of that happened in the space of just a few months. And where we are now with vaccines and also with therapeutics, monoclonal antibodies now causing a lot of excitement as a treatment for people who are infected and who might be able to be kept out of the hospital with this intervention. That's just exhilarating to see. And I get to work with people like Tony Fauci, who's the leader of all of this effort, but lots of other people joining in from other parts of NIH and making this their passion. It is remarkable. The science has been breathtaking.
Well, it's interesting that you describe this tremendous coordination, because I think from the public's perspective, and all we know is what we're seeing on the news and reading in the paper, it's felt disjointed with multiple different speakers, people in charge, and different committees and different policy groups, and it hasn't felt like a coordinated effort. And I don't want to put you on the spot for any of that, but it's really gratifying to hear that on the at the side that you see of scientists working with both public and government, private and government providers, that there has been tremendous coordinated effort.
Yeah, I think you heard some of those same words from Tony, that the science has been zeroed in with great effectiveness and moving at a pace never seen before. Meanwhile, there's a lot of noise around all of this, and probably what comes across in the evening news has more noise than it has science, and we would love, of course, to see that ratio change a little bit. And maybe now that we're starting to see these kinds of results with vaccines that have 90% plus efficacy, that will start to be more of the news that people are anxious to hear. And let's be clear, this is a very polarized time in our country and in other countries as well, and that tends to be what makes the news, that people aren't agreeing with each other. Well, that's breaking news. The fact that you had an advance scientifically and you ran a trial that had a good outcome, well, that's nice, but it's not where people are fighting. So we have our own issues, I think, in terms of the way in which information gets shared. Scientists could do a better job of portraying what we do in a fashion that makes it more digestible and less sort of off-putting and jargon-laden, and we need to work on that as well.
Dr. Borio, a moment ago you said one of the things the task force will be looking at is what, not a full lockdown, but the sort of right kind of controls to get us back on track. Can you tell us a little more about what you're thinking? You know, it's almost sort of strategic decision-making about what to restrict and what to keep open.
Well, I can't speak for the task force. We just began to do our work. But I think that Dr. Fauci really delineated the issues that, you know, when we implement public health measures that are prudent and consistently, we're able to contain the outbreak in the absence, you know, without having to do lockdowns. In a lockdown, a lot of measures are curtailed that do not to be curtailed because they don't really offer an advantage to, you know, containing the epidemic. But I think it's the fact that the American public is tired and they're confused about what really needs to be done. The communications haven't been, Dr. Fauci has been very consistent, but, you know, we haven't seen across the government consistent, clear action and recommendations. And I think it's just natural for people to be tired and fatigued and just confused about what's the best course of action for them. And the measures, you know, again, it's about clear, consistent communications. So people understand what measures they can follow to help themselves, their families, their communities. We need to really develop a much stronger strategy for how we use diagnostic tests and augment the use of diagnostic tests. We need to think about how we amplify the public health workforce to do contact tracing. We need to, you know, also increase the delivery of medical care and capacity and the access to care. We've seen the health disparities have really been a significant, a very sad story for us to see the increased number of cases and morbidity and mortality associated with people of color and lower socioeconomic status. That's a very disturbing numbers. We need to be able to turn this around and gain the trust of the American public. The work ahead is, there's a lot of work ahead, but I'm confident that working together, that we can replicate the success of the science response in the other domains of, you know, this comprehensive response.
There is so much to follow up on there. I don't know where to begin. It seems like one of the most critical questions, and so hard, is to deal with the disproportionate impact that we've seen on people of color and people of low income in this country, and I'm sure there's other globally other sort of targeted communities that are harder hit than others. As we think about treatment and vaccines, how do we target people in a way that makes them want to embrace early use of vaccine because it's out of caring and not for them to assume that they're being experimented on? I mean, I think some people say, well, I'll take a vaccine after we've had plenty of time to see how it works, but I'm not going to be the one early on. And so to be targeted in a vaccine may be the last thing that certain people want. Dr. Collins?
It's a really important question and one that has occupied the attention of a lot of us in the course of the last few months. Now that these large-scale trials for vaccines are underway, do you really want to just test them in young, healthy white people? No. You want to particularly find out, do they work in vulnerable groups, in people over 65, people with chronic illness, African Americans, Latinx, Native Americans who have shouldered an undue amount of the burden. And yet, this happens at exactly the moment, as you're pointing out in your question, where there's a distrust about whether medical researchers really have the best interests of those minority communities at heart, the first thing that often comes up in a conversation is Tuskegee. We have this long and really unfortunate history of how medical research has not always behaved ethically when it came to underrepresented groups. And we have to get out there and explain that and apologize for that, as President Clinton did, and then try to make the case that this is not like that. This is one of those things where we're not targeting. We want to be inclusive. We want to be able to offer the opportunity to be in these trials so that we can find out, does this work for all the people who might need it the most? And I can tell you, having me as, you know, the head of the NIH say that, it doesn't help that much. What really helps is engaging the communities, finding who are the spokespersons in those communities who are trusted and who can look at the evidence and can say, you know, we really should be part of this. We're doing a lot of that right now. The Moderna vaccine that Dr. Fauci mentioned, which you'll be hearing some news about in the next few days, I guess, because it seems like they're getting to that same point of finding out what the efficacy is. We worked really hard with the leaders of that company to take what was going to be a pretty unimpressive diversity of enrollment. And by pushing hard, bringing on board a whole group called SEAL, which stands for Community Engagement Alliance, we were able, at the end of the enrollment of 30,000, more than 10% of those were African Americans, more than 20% were Latinx, total 37% of that group were people of color. It could be even better, but that is so much better than where it was. We learned a lot of lessons from that. Tony was a big part of that with me. And I think we could now apply that more broadly in other examples like this to try to turn the corner so we're not talking about Tuskegee as the only example, where people can point to something and say, well, that time they did it right. We want to do it right.
And if I may add, you know, these trials that are being done, they're the gold standard, right? The double-blind, placebo-controlled studies, and they offer really very high-quality data about these vaccine safety and effectiveness, but it's still limited the information to the trial population. So it's going to be really important after these trials are completed to and as these vaccines are rolled out to a larger segment of the population, to continually monitor for their safety, because communications can be, trust can be built on strong safety data. And to continue looking for safety signals, rare adverse events, how this vaccine is performing across different populations, it's going to be critical. So the work doesn't end once these trials are completed.
Both of you have worked through Ebola and the response to that. How transferable is the social science aspects of that, of how to prepare for people to be willing to be vaccinated, how to get into a community that might be skeptical worldwide in order to make it as effective as possible? Or is each one of these events so different from the other that it's hard to translate from one to another?
Since Ebola never became a major threat to the United States, despite the intense population anxiety about it, we didn't have the experience of trying to see if people would be willing to roll up their sleeves for that vaccine. The vaccinations were done where the disease was happening in West Africa and more recently in DRC. So I'm not sure we learned about the social science. We did learn about some other things. The monoclonal antibodies that now are showing promise for COVID-19, similar approach for Ebola in a very challenging trial that was run essentially in a war zone, showed that those monoclonal antibodies could be life-saving and gave additional confidence to the idea that this might work for other infectious diseases. I think when it comes to the social science part in our own country, you have to look at other examples, and there's really nothing quite like what we're looking at now in terms of something that is so devastating. As Tony said, the most horrible pandemic we've had in 102 years and all of the public attention that comes with it. It's a little hard to extrapolate. We can look at the fact that there's been growing in some quarters a vaccine hesitancy, and this has certainly given an opportunity for those anxieties to expand, and social media has been great at promoting conspiracy theories that have added to that. I don't know if you've looked at conspiracy theories on social media. Some of them are just really creative, but there are people I talk to who say, well, I'm not going to have that vaccine because Bill Gates put a chip in it and it's going to go into me and then it's going to wire my brain. And people have read that and they think that's probably real. So come on, people, let's look at the evidence of what's really happening here. I am hopeful, as Tony articulated a little bit ago, that when people actually have the data in front of them, it's been hypothetical, it's been very much overridden by various claims about timetables and political agendas. Let's get past all of that. Look at the data. Tell me, why would you not want to take advantage of something that might protect you and your family and other people you love from a terrible disease? If you have a good answer to that, that's good. Let's hear the answer. But let's not have it be because Bill Gates has put his chip in that syringe.
Speaking of looking at the disease, you brought a wonderful little show and tell piece. Do you want to tell us? We've been talking about the coronavirus now for 10 months or something, and we don't really know what we're talking about, most of us.
Well, you see this symbol in almost everything now. We're just talking about it's on every pumpkin this year. This is what it looks like. This is this coronavirus. It's a spherical virus, but it has these spike proteins on the surface, which are really important because they're the ones that enable this virus to get inside your cells. That spike protein finds a match in a protein on your cells called ACE2, and that lets it jump into the cell and start copying itself like crazy. So what do we want to do in terms of developing a vaccine? You want to get a way for your immune system to make antibodies that will attach to those spikes, like, you know, chewing gum stuck all over them, and keep them from being able to get into your cells. That's what we're trying to do. So all the vaccines are basically trying to raise antibodies against these spike proteins. This is a fancy version where the spike proteins have two different colors because they have sort of an open and a closed configuration. That's a fine point. But basically, it's those spike proteins that we are all trying to immunize against, and which looks like it's working pretty well, at least with the first one or two out of the gate. And there are six now that are in the works. Operation Warp Speed, which taxpayers are paying for, and well, they should be because of the critical need for this, is not only helping support many of the trials, but also supporting manufacturing. Imagine if we didn't do that. We ran the trials, and we had a big announcement. Guess what? We've got a vaccine that works great, but you're going to have to wait 6 months for us to build a factory and make enough doses for people. Well, that's not happening. Warp Speed is doing what you call at-risk manufacturing, making millions, tens of millions of doses, even before you know if that vaccine is going to work. And if that one doesn't, you throw them out. But if it does, you're ready to go, which we hope to be in December. We've saved probably many months and many lives by that investment, and that is unprecedented. It's one more thing that we've done in this country that has never been done before.
It's remarkable. Dr. Borio, I want to switch gears a little bit, because you come to this with both experience in working in the Obama and Trump administrations, but also your focus has been not on so much on pandemics as health crises. They are health crises, but as not as sort of purely the medical issues, but coming at it from the perspective of a bioterrorism threat to our country and to the world, a very different kind of focus. So tell us a little bit about that. How do you assess a biological agent like this, and how does the response differ when you're thinking of it from a security point of view as opposed to a health crisis?
Well, fundamentally it's a health issue. And I have to say that every time I was working on a policy document or an effort, it really was with the eye to the patient who's going to be in the hospital, you know, and how at the bed, what would make a difference at the bedside, and how do we prevent them from getting to that point. So it's a health issue. And the National Biodefense Strategy that was published in 2018 makes it very clear that biological threats, we're agnostic to the origin of the threat, that deliberate threats, accidental threats, and naturally occurring threats are equally important. And again, fundamentally health issues that can have significant disruptive power to our economy, the fabric of our society, confidence in political systems, a lot of other impacts, but fundamentally a health issue. I think perhaps one of the most concerning factors is that, one, of course, creates other geopolitical risks because we're talking about somebody deliberately developing and using a weapon to cause harm to the health of a population. So there is that that layer, but we can't let that distract from the fact that at the end of the day, it's about saving lives.
Well, and I think the early stages as we were all grappling with what this was, involved a lot of conversation about whether this was an intentional release of something in order to harm other countries. Was it an accidental release? Was it just something that you know, bad luck and it's jumped from animal to human? Was it created in a lab? That seems to have sort of gotten in the way of at least the public's understanding of what was going on for many, many months. Maybe for some people still is getting in the way of being able to trust the information. Do you have a sense of that?
Sure, and I think it validates my point that ultimately we can't let that distract us from the work that needs to be done on to develop the science response, to work on the public health measures, because at the end of the day, all we need to do is focus on the patient at the bedside and how do we prevent them from getting there, right? The doctor at the bedside and the patient. How do we prevent that from happening? How do we minimize the morbidity and mortality? And there'll be a time where then there will be, you know, looks to see if there was any possibility, you know, something that we may never really know. And I think that most scientists do not think that this was a deliberate or accidental. I think that it's been pretty ruled out that this is a deliberate issue, but, you know, we never know. But it doesn't really matter at the end of the day. I'll just say that it really shows also how important it is for us to be ready to address these biological threats, because this is not going to be the last epidemic. We hope that it doesn't grow to be this significant in the future, but it won't. The way we behave today, the way we encroach in animal habitats, the speed of travel, there's so many urbanization, population density. You know, this creates a milieu that it's really makes it easier for there to be spillover viruses from animals to humans, and we need to be always vigilant. And I hope that this week going forward, you know, we continue to apply more technology and strengthen our systems end to end, not just in drug discovery and medical response, but also ability to forecast and predict and do surveillance more effectively.
President Trump withdrew us from the World Health Organization, and President-elect Biden has said that he wants to put us back into it again. What's the practical effect of that? I mean, is that going to be useful on what you describe as being ready, Dr. Borio, sort of ready to go when something does become apparent? Or is it coordination of data, of research? You know, to the public, I don't know what that means. It just sounds like a good idea, but I don't really know why.
Go ahead. The WHO is very important to all this response, clearly, very.
It's a good thing that infectious disease research has been international for many decades. And even with the tensions with the WHO, I think it's fair to say a fair amount of international exchange has been going on. And we still interact with staff at the WHO almost every day. So it has not been a severe downturn in the international attention to this. And this is a time where we need international attention. It will be interesting to see what happens next.
And what happens overseas, epidemics that happen overseas, matter to us, right? We have because we want to prevent them from coming here, and also because sometimes they impact areas that are of interest to our national security or economic security. So we really, it does matter. And WHO, I think that most people don't even appreciate here is that there are instances where they are on the ground working to, you know, boots on the ground to contain an epidemic that it's very difficult for Americans to be because of their conflict zones and, you know, war zones difficult. So, you know, the WHO is essential in being leaders and to help coordinate the global response to these types of crises.
Are we getting better in our preparedness? Do you think that you see a sort of upward trajectory of improved response capability year to year?
Lou, you should answer. I know you're part of this Committee on Foreign Council on Foreign Relations efforts to talk about preparedness.
Yes, and my full-time job is at InQtel, which we invest in technologies as a non-for-profit strategic investor. And our chief technology officer told me the other day, he says, you know, Lou, we do more than technology. Our business is optimism. And I thought that was very good because it's actually true. I think the future is brighter. It's remarkable what has already happened in the last few months with the diagnostic space, for example.
Yeah.
and thanks a lot to your efforts in bringing that to where it is, taking that low-hanging fruit. Maybe you want to talk a little bit about where we are today with diagnostics?
Sure, I'd love to. Because we all would agree that if we could snap our fingers and have a home-based test that you could take every morning and find out whether you have gotten infected, in which case you probably shouldn't be going to work and you should be isolating yourself and thinking about contacts, that would be fantastic. My thought experiment is, suppose it's on your toothbrush, and so you just find out as soon as you get your day started. Well, we're not quite there yet. But we've had a focus until very recently where testing is for people with symptoms, and we need that, and we're pretty good at that now. But what we really need is testing for people who don't have symptoms, because that's where community spread is happening. That's what colleges need in order to be able to keep their students and their faculty safe and keep their classes going and not send everybody home. And now we are developing, I think, a whole lot of new technologies that are like that. They are point of care, which means you don't have to do the swab and send it off to some central lab and hope you get an answer back in a day or two. You get the answer right then, or in 30 minutes. At NIH, we have this program called RADx, which I like the name. It stands for Rapid Acceleration of Diagnostics. And with funds from the Congress that were only provided in April, we set up essentially kind of a venture capital system to look at academic labs and small businesses that had really cool ideas about how to do rapid detection of this SARS-CoV-2 virus. And in the space of that very short period of time, we've now funded 22 of these technologies that collectively are about to get to the point of 3 million tests a day, more than half of which are point of care. And we're starting very soon to try this in home testing, because that's where we really want to get. This is an example about how this crisis has absolutely lit a fire under what otherwise would have been technologies that would have happened over a few years, but have now happened over a few months. And that's going to have a lot of spin-offs for other applications as well. And that's sort of my hope of what we can really push hard on in the next few months, is to get the testing situation where it needs to be, so that as we're waiting for the vaccines to get available to everybody, and we're still dealing with this winter season, we have a better chance of capturing the pandemic before it gets even worse.
It's an amazing period of time, and the anxiety that people are demonstrating is so extreme. There's the press covers a lot of the people who are resistant, but we asked for questions from people, you know, before in advance of tonight, and you've heard about a little of those. It was remarkable to read. There were over 100 questions that came in, and many, many of them just express a genuine uncertainty about what to do, and you know, what to do for Thanksgiving is, you know, is one example, but much more than that. They have a child with a pre-existing condition, and they should they send them back to school? They're, you know, they want to be able to visit their aged aunt before she dies, and they're afraid to do it. They don't know whether they can travel, and they, you know, have just been planning on a trip for, you know, the past 2 years, and it's It was really kind of sad to read how many people are really troubled and wondered, where do you go for good, reliable, unbiased information? What is the is there a place that the government is collecting all that kind of information? Does NIH do that? Is that something the task force is thinking about to help people be smart about decision making?
It's really the job for the CDC, and if you go to their website, there's lots and lots of information there that people can sift through. And of course, they're not the only place that's offering this up. Dr. Fauci is, I think, probably the source of this kind of information that most people have heard and depended on, and has always said it just exactly like it should be said, because these are the facts. But the facts are changing. Let's be clear about that. We're getting new information all the time. If people feel like, hey, they said something different this time than they did the last time, it's probably because we had new information, and so the recommendation needed to change. But I would say start with CDC, and then all of us who are in the middle of this are getting barraged by questions many times a day. And they don't all have easy answers. People who really desperately want to get together for a holiday, maybe because they think this might be the last Thanksgiving for the grandmother, and you're going to say, you know, that's just not safe. That's a hard thing to hear. I get that. I'm not going to have Thanksgiving with my family this year because of people in the family who are at risk. And I'm going to miss that. First time in 27 years there has not been a gathering of 30 or so people around the table. But it just, when you put all the evidence together, we can get by this year without that. This is like we're going to get through a serious worldwide crisis, and it will have an end. And as Tony said, if we can start to appreciate that there is a light up there somewhere, maybe that will allow us to redouble our efforts to get through in the meantime and come out to the point where we can finally say, okay, that one's in the rearview mirror. We're stronger as a result. We got a lot of work to do to pull ourselves back together again. We made it. We can do that.
Second that.
This is all part of your working in optimism. Is that what you said at the beginning?
Right. Yeah.
You know, one of the things that one of the questioners that was, I thought was so interesting said, and I know, Dr. Collins, you're a man of faith and you've written a lot about your faith. The question was, is there any data that shows that people's outcomes are better if they have an important faith, whatever it may be, in their lives? Are either of you aware of any kind of research that would support that?
I don't know about COVID-19. That's a good research question that somebody should be pursuing if they're not already. Pay attention here, y'all. You just got a great tip of a possibly fundable NIH grant. But in other circumstances, yeah, there is evidence that people who have a spiritual part of their daily life seem to have more resilience when it comes to health issues and other things. It's not a huge effect, but it's certainly in there. The dean this evening started off with Psalm 46, which certainly been very much on my mind. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. And we're in trouble. And to have that sense that we're not all alone here, that God is our refuge and strength and is going to provide help, although it's up to us to figure out how to help ourselves and not just say, well, okay, I've just got to let it happen however it's going to. We have a lot of strengths and capabilities. Let's use those. But also having this confidence that there's something more than what you can see here. That, for me, is a great source of comfort.
Well, I think that couldn't be a better way to invite the dean back on again to wrap things up. We could go on forever, but there's just, our time is limited. I thank you so much for your time, for your wisdom, for all of the work you're doing to advance our response, and for keeping us safe. So thank you.
My pleasure.
If you all would join me up here and we'll spread out across the front. My thanks to the Ignatius family and to our wonderful guests for being with us tonight and for the incredible conversations that we had. We're blessed by having all of you with us this evening. Thank you. And God bless and keep all of you out there. I hope you will stay safe and sound and well. And may the blessing of our Lord, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you this day and always. Good night, everyone. Thank you for being with us.